My name is Michael Moyes. Welcome to our open house. I'm the director of admissions here at Berklee Online. And as many of you know, we do these open houses quite often. We bring people like Dave in here, who are professors, to teach us a few things about their classes and about music. Dave Limina is a professor in the piano department here at the Berklee College of Music, in addition to the online programs here. He has performed as a keyboardist, composer, and arranger with Gloria Estefan, the Courage Brothers, Mark Murphy, one of my favorites, Eric Krasno, and many others, dozens and dozens of others, actually. He just came off of a tour, I believe, right? Mm-hmm. He is the author and professor of two of our keyboard classes, the Blues and Rock keyboard class, which I coincidentally took a few years ago online, and also our Pop and Rock keyboard class. So we've got about 25 to 30 minutes here, and we're just going to kind of play around and talk about a few different concepts, and maybe we'll learn a thing or two. I come from a classical music background. I've been doing this kind of stuff for a while now as well, but when I started taking your class, I was pretty much playing Bach, Rachmaninoff, that type of stuff. And the concept of a lead sheet was pretty new to me. Okay, I have no notes. I have a blank piece of paper, and it's got these things that say C, F, G, and you play things like this, and I'm like, well, that doesn't sound at all like the song that it's supposed to sound like. So one of the first things I struggled with was how to make it sound a little bit more good in a blues type sense.
Well, this is a very common situation. We have a lot of people that are very well trained classically, and they know a lot about scales. They know a lot about sight reading. Musicianship skills are strong, but in the contemporary world, which is what we are teaching in our courses here, a lot of the information given you is based on something called a lead sheet, where you're given more skeletal information. So you may be seeing a manuscript paper that gives you the form of the song. It might give you the melody. It may even give you some other specific things, but the harmony can be very general. Like, you may see something like the chord symbol may just say C, which means a C major triad. Okay. It doesn't tell you how many times to play the C triad. It doesn't tell you which inversion to play it in. It doesn't tell you what rhythms to play. So you have to base all that on your knowledge of the style, what you're hearing from the other instruments in the band, and your general knowledge of what you can do harmonically. So I think I have a track we can play right now.
Yeah, let's get into it and get some examples.
So it's very normal to be looking at a lead sheet, which we see these a lot in something called a fake book, which is a book of lead sheets that you may see of tunes. And you may open it up and say, okay, there's the melody. I can play the melody, but C7, what do I do? And many of you may be able to sit down and go, okay, here's C, C major triad. And C7 means C dominant 7, where we put the seventh of the scale flatted on top of that. That's a very common sound in blues, rock, and pop, okay? And we're gonna, I'm gonna play along with this track for classic Willson Pickett tune called Mustang Sally. And a lot of the tune is just C7. So you have this one chord for all this time going by. And I was, you know, like you too, I would see this chord symbol and go, I don't know what to do. So even with training in jazz, it's a different style. So you really have to know what is musically appropriate for that song. And this is something that we really get into in depth in the online pop rock course. So I'm going to play along with this, and I'll take you through some different concepts. So here's the groove. There's a band playing. And the harmony is C7. So I can do this. Play it on the beat. Okay, sounds okay. Now if I add some rhythm to it, it's a
little better.
Now we have F7. Back to C7. Take you through the cycle. G7. Stop on F7. There's all this space. So I'm gonna stop the track there. So I took the chord and I played a rhythmic groove that goes along with the band. Okay. Now that's based on what you know of the style, what you've heard before, patterns that you may have practiced. Okay. There's no rules though. It's not like the information is not there. It's based on what you've already studied, mm-hmm. and your musical ear and your musical instincts, and you just put all that into what you're doing. And the overarching concepts are that you play in time with the band, that you groove with the band, and your part kind of fits with the other parts on the track. Okay, you're not, you know, doing something that's maybe too active, you know. And generally, less can be more. All right. So that's kind of a basic, you know, point to start from. And in these styles, the rock pop styles, generally at the keyboard, we're playing a chord structure in our right hand, and left hand is playing the root of the chord. So C7, and left hand playing a C. Okay. And I can groove with that. Okay. Now that's just a start. Now, we do this in the blues rock course and in the pop rock course. We talk about what else we can do with this C7, because it's going on for a long time. And this is something that you may or may not be, you know, interested in, but the scale we use for this chord is called the Mixolydian scale, and that's a major scale with the seventh degree flatted. We rarely play it as a scale in the song. Mm-hmm. Now the interesting thing is, if we use only notes from this scale, we can create triads. Like here's a triad using the seventh, the third, and the fifth. Triad using the root, the fourth, and the sixth. And a triad using the second, the fifth, and the flat seven. And these work because they're all from that chord scale, the C7 or the C Mixolydian chord scale. And this enters into a concept that we're going to that rhythm section players do all the time. This is called comping. Now, comping is an improvised accompaniment. Okay. In classical music, the composer writes down what you play for the accompaniment. If you're accompanying a singer or a soloist, that's already is written out. It's predetermined by the composer. In the contemporary world, we are improvising on this. Okay, roughly, it's not like, you know, magically. It's just, wow, you know, this just happened. Mm-hmm. It's based on what you've done before and things that you already know. So I'm going to use these three Mixolydian triads now and create a comping pattern for the song. Okay, so I'm going to pick it up from where we left off. F7. Thank you. So
big difference.
Lots of stuff there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Definitely. That was great. I was noticing that technique-wise, it's really not too demanding for a classical player. It's just it's more mentally demanding, getting your mind in shape.
Yes, and you have to let go. it's okay. You know, it can be kind of strange. Like, oh my gosh, is this? You know, am I doing? You know, the right thing. You know, is this what's appropriate? Right. But use your ears. You know, and when I was playing, I was really focusing on the band and getting my time to really listen to the drums and the bass and locking in. I was doing some accents with my left hand. You know. Little grace notes. Mm-hmm. It's a stylistic thing that adds a lot of flavor.
Yeah.
And authenticity to what you're playing. Now, I was also doing some kind of more fill kind of solo ideas. Mm-hmm. Maybe we could get into that a little
bit. Yeah, most definitely.
Okay. So, playing a solo, it's like, wow, you know, for a lot of people, it's like, I have no idea what to do. Okay. So I like to tell people, if you do two things, you're probably going to be on the right track and it's probably going to sound good. Mm-hmm. Okay. First thing is to groove. So, you know, whatever you play should groove with the track, and then it should also phrase. Mm-hmm. So to groove and phrase. So a phrase being a complete musical thought that has a clear beginning and a clear conclusion. And if you're doing those two things, and I guess maybe there is a third thing that is implied, that you're playing the right harmonic material, okay? So if I do all this stuff that I did in C, all right? So I'm using the C triads from the C, from the C Mixolydian blues, the C Mixolydian scale. Mm-hmm. And then if I also use C blues scale, now a blues scale is some different notes within the scale that are altered. So it sounds like this. So I have third is flat. There's a passing tone between the fourth and the fifth, and the seventh again is flat. Mm-hmm. Very common sound. If I use that, this is the note set, the set of notes that work for me to groove and phrase with.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So I'm going to demonstrate that now. Okay, so here's a little more of this track. Okay. Here we go. Play a solo. Advanced, you can do things like, So I hope you could hear all that in the.
So. Oh, I got all of it. Yeah. Okay.
So, no problem. The grooving and the phrasing.
Yeah.
Okay, so we start it up. Then answer that phrase. Simple. As you know, it starts and it ends like a little arc of a phrase.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something you can experiment with, and it takes some time. It's new. Oh my gosh. Okay. You know, but in the courses, I give you some licks and you know ideas to get started with, and we practice those. You know. Repeatedly to get used to that. And that becomes your vocabulary.
Mm-hmm.
It's like when you are telling a story, you have to have a vocabulary. You have to use, you know, verbs and nouns, and music is the same way.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have a vocabulary. So here we have our blues scale, we have our Mixolydian triads, we have our groove, we have our phrasing.
Mm-hmm.
We put that all together, and that's when it all happens.
You just did something that terrifies most musicians, which I think is pretty important to do, which was you sang along with what you were doing.
Yeah.
And that's something that I find very uncomfortable as a player.
Yeah.
However, I can't deny that when you're talking about phrasing and thinking about how not to just play the blues scale up and down and have no real coherent thought that comes through to the listener, actually singing something yourself when you're practicing can slow your brain down a little bit. And
that's an excellent point.
Because, well, you did it.
Well, everything should be based on a vocal phrase.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
It simulates breathing. Is that right?
Yes.
Is that the whole
yes. And that
premise?
Allows the listener to take your phrase in. If you're just playing, if I'm going. You know, that is cool for like a minute, and then you're like, well, okay, you know, hold on.
Yeah.
So it has to phrase like a singer would phrase. And we talk about this in the blues course. It's like you're telling a story, but there's no lyrics. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
In blues, there are lyrics. And it's very important to get in touch with that, to get back to the roots of these styles and where that, you know, concept was from. You know, I'm telling a story. And that's one thought. Next thought. Then I'm gonna tell you some more about the story. Mm-hmm. You know, and you got to get over, you know, how your voice sounds. You know,
right?
It's just about connecting with the breathing and the phrasing and the pitch, all that stuff can help make it happen. So when you're listening to music, you should, you know, you're, you know, and I'm sure most of you sing your favorite songs. You know, so it's just keep, you know. Singing, I tell people to listen to somebody like B.B. King, the way he plays the guitar. Sing his guitar solos. It's his phrasing is perfect, you know, and you really get a sense of how to, you know, how to make that connect with your hand on to the instrument. So,
I'm interested to learn more about the pop side of things as well. That was that was pretty bluesy. One thing that I notice a lot, and I'm sure all of us do, is that it seems like there's a lot of common chord progressions in pop music. Would you find that that's kind of true since you played a lot?
There's I outlined these a little bit in the pop rock course. You know, and it's important to be able to recognize them. You know, because it's a lot of the same vocabulary. This is the vocabulary of the style. And you really got to get into that a little bit. There's the famous Journey tune, you know. I'm not playing it right, but, you know. It's 1-5, 6-4. What does that mean? Okay. It's all related to, I'll do a really, really fast version of this. It's all related to the major scale. This is in the key of E, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The first chord is the chord built on 1. This is E major. Okay. 5 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. B major built on 5. 6 is C sharp minor. So the 6 chord is always minor. And the 4 chord is major. Now, I just played in a tour where one of the singers had a song, and it was literally one of the exercises right from the pop rock course.
Oh, really?
Where we were going over 1-5-6-4. Okay. And I was like, wow, this is from the course. And it was doing a broken triad comping pattern that we study in the course. And I was like, and there it is. And it was literally in C going to 5. 6-4. Okay. And for some of you, that may be like, wow, this is really new and I got to get into this. Some of you may be like, well, okay, that's just C, G, A, and A minor and F. Easy. Mm-hmm. Okay. We also try to stress that, okay, on a certain aspect of it may be easy, but when I played this show, it was a very slow tempo, and I was going, okay, I really got to focus on the band, because if I'm playing that pattern and I'm not right with the band, that's going to stick out.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not, you know, it won't sound good. Okay, you know, it needs to be right in the pocket, grooving, and that can be hard to do. So that's another aspect of the music that we want to focus on is the time and making that feel good.
Mm-hmm. Are there specific artists that influenced you or different styles that influenced you?
Me specifically, I'm influenced by a very wide, you know, range of things. I was really into jazz. Most of the playing I've done has been jazz.
Oh, actually. Okay.
But I love pop. I love pop that's good.
Yeah.
You know, I love Elton John, his recordings from the 70s. Mm-hmm. I think he kind of defined the pop rock, you know, style for the piano. You
mm-hmm.
know. I love Bruce Hornsby.
Oh, yeah.
He's a little out of, you know, not at the forefront now, but, you know, back in the 80s and the 90s. A lot of jazz and blues, you know, mm-hmm. players. I love Dr. John.
Is awesome. New Orleans.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. And we do a concept in the blues rock course that can give you a quick intro to the New Orleans flavor.
That would be great.
I can show you.
Yeah.
And again, based on a C triad. So if I take my C triad and play it like this, okay. And I'm gonna play the lick for you first. It sounds like this.
I remember that one.
Yeah. Dr. John calls that the famous lick. I call it the cascade lick because it's often played cascading down the keyboard. Okay, and that gives you an instant flavor of. Sounds really cool. It's actually pretty simple, and it's based on a C triad. Okay, and I'm playing the fifth, then the third, and the fifth.
Mm-hmm.
If you can't reach that, you can kind of, you know, rotate your wrist, mm-hmm. and then we're going to go to F and A. So it's kind of like I'm moving from a C triad to an F triad. And then you're going to here's the trick to it. You're going to roll down a C major triad using 4 notes.
It's just an arpeggio.
Yeah. And you want to make that roll kind of fast and crisp. So I tell people to practice that until you can get that to... Yeah. So, and then you put together. That's it. Sounded great.
I remember.
And then if you add a grace note, it's even more stylized.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Then, to cascade down the piano, and on G, and I cross over, cross over to the F and A mm-hmm. again, and then I'm playing an E flat this time. So, then I reset, and I roll the triad again.
Oh, you just do the same thing all the way down.
Yeah, I'll do that again slowly. And if you are economical with your hand motion, it's not so hard.
Yeah, it looks like you're laboring at all.
Yeah. And that's a, you know, one thing that we study to get us into that style. You know? Mm-hmm. So the Dr. John New Orleans thing.
Yeah, that's something most classical players should be able to be pretty comfortable with.
Yeah.
Everybody does arpeggios up and down the keyboard. So.
And that's a lick. You know, there's another name for that lick is the million dollar lick because you hear it on.
Yeah.
You know, TV show theme might start up. You know, you can use it in, you know, if you're playing a song. Maybe at the end of a song. I'll do it on a blues. Okay, so very.
So it doesn't just have to apply to New Orleans style at all.
Very usable.
That's great.
Yeah,
we're getting kind of short on time. Okay. But did you have anything else that you wanted to play along with?
We could play along with a kind of a Motownish, R&B-ish.
Oh, that'd be great.
Kind of
ballad,
medium tempo, kind of a ballad.
Because you cover a lot of that in the pop rock.
Yes, right? Yes. We do a lot of different styles of pop. This is the Marvin Gaye tune, What's Going On? And I have the tracks, and I'll show you, you know, some of the concepts that you might do with this. A little bit different than all this, you know, bluesier stuff. This song is an E, and the first chord is an E major 7. So it's E, triad, with the 7th of the scale. So it's E major. Okay, and the main two chords are E major 7 to C sharp minor 7. Those are the two chords. Okay, and I'll go through some different things, and then we'll talk about it. So here. So there's the tune. I want to be familiar with that groove first, kind of like a medium tempo. I'll play my E major 7. C sharp minor 7. Just kind of rolling the chord.
And
long tones are good in this style. F sharp minor 7. A over B. Now I'll use different inversions of the chords. Nothing wrong with just laying down the chord and letting it ring. Mm-hmm. And then I'm doing a little arpeggio up here. It's kind of a nice style for that. Okay. Not so hard to, you know, to get under your fingers. Then we could also play a rhythmic groove. And that would be based on what you're hearing. There is a guitar playing the rhythm, so you don't want to get too much. But maybe... So gonna start it again and do it from that point on. So with a little rhythm. Oh, sorry.
Oh, that was
the first. Here we go. First. Good. sharp minor. So that's a different style.
That's great.
Of pop.
Well, thank you again for joining us, Dave. It's been excellent having you here. And thanks to all of you for joining us. We do have our summer term coming up on July 1st, and we'd love to have you join us. We're going to be enrolling for both of Dave's online classes, the blues and rock keyboard techniques and the pop rock piano class. And we're actually offering $100 off for anybody who enrolls for the summer term, either for Dave's courses or for any of our courses. So feel free to call an advisor at 1-866-Berklee. That's 1-866-Berklee. And they're here basically to help you figure out which classes are going to be best for you. So if you want to play us out, Dave, it would be great.